Well, good morning. Welcome to the Butteville Community Church. It is so good to have you with us this morning, and I'm so grateful to hear all of the lovely voices and chatting and banter. I almost hate to cut it off. Good to see you this morning, and welcome. There's just a few things I want to announce for us this morning in our bulletins. First of all, thanks to Wendy, I suppose, for all of these wonderful pictures with the baby shower. I'm glad that those ladies were able to get together and have a joyful time and blessing Mallory and family. There's just a few things I'd like to announce, some changes that we've started to do. First of all, one change already took place this morning. We're moving our Sunday school time, our adult Sunday school, from 9 o'clock in the morning to 9:30. So you all officially have an extra half hour to sleep or do your hair or whatever you need to do. And then I would encourage you, come and dig into God's Word with us. It's a good time of Bible study together. Secondly, we have another change that's coming up this week, and that is our prayer meeting that has been meeting on Wednesdays at 6 p.m. I know there's several folks that have difficulties driving at night and whatnot with 6 p.m., so we're going to be changing our prayer meeting up and doing something different. 12:30 p.m. in the middle of the day on Wednesdays, we're asking you, encouraging you, come on out for a shortened time of prayer, probably about a half hour, where we're going to pray on Wednesdays. Wednesdays in the middle of the day is a bustling time of life in our church. We have elders that are meeting. We have ladies that are quilting. And our plan is to come in here and have a song, a little scripture devo, and some time of prayer together. So I'd encourage you, 12:30 p.m. on Wednesdays, we're trying something new. Come on out and pray with us. Well, it is good to be in the house of the Lord, and I want to start us off with a reading of God's Word as we begin our time of worship. This is the Word of God from Psalm 136, verses 1 through 5. Give thanks to the Lord, for He is good, for His steadfast love endures forever. Give thanks to the God of gods, for His steadfast love endures forever. Give thanks to the Lord of lords, for His steadfast love endures forever. To Him who alone does great wonders, for His steadfast love endures forever. To Him who by understanding made the heavens, for His steadfast love endures forever. Lord, we praise You that You are good and that You are God, that You are God of gods and Lord of lords, that You created the heavens and the earth, that You stretched out the waters, that You made us and sustain us by Your grace. We pray as we come together this morning that You would help us to worship You, that You would tune our hearts to sing Your praise, for You are good and Your steadfast love endures forever. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Would you all please stand as you're able? We will be starting with Thy Word. Roger and Nancy are off having fun somewhere without us, so we're going to have fun here without them.
Thy word is a lamp to my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp to my feet and a light unto my path. When I feel afraid and I think I've lost my way, still You're there right beside me. Nothing will I fear as long as You are near. Please be near me to the end. Thy word is a lamp to my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp to my feet and a light unto my path. I will not forget your love for me, and yet my heart forever is wandering. Jesus, be my guide and hold me to your side. I will love you to the end. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. And a light unto my path.
All right, at this point we'll dismiss our children to the fun and learning that await in Children's Sunday School. So grab your Bibles and let's head over this way. Let's pray, shall we? Lord, we thank you for the gift that we have, that we can come before you and know your word. We would pray that your word would be a lamp for our feet, a light to our path. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Bye, kids.
You can remain seated for this next one. This is How Deep the Father's Love.
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only Son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing love, the Father turns his face away, as wounds betray the chosen one, bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon his shoulders, ashamed I hear thy mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. I will not boast in anything, no gifts, no power, no should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom. Thank you. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I'll worship Your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship Your holy name. You're rich in love and You're slow to anger. Your name is great and Your heart is kind. For all Your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I'll worship Your holy name. Near and my time has come, still my soul will sing Your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship Your holy name. I'll worship Your holy name. Lord, I'll worship Your holy name.
Lord, thank You for letting us all be here to worship with You. Be with us during Jacob's sermon, and be with the children as they're off learning what they're learning right now. Amen.
Thank you, Joey and team, for leading us in song as always. As we prepare our hearts to come before God's Word, let's have a time of prayer. If you want to, open your hands before the Lord. I know there's lots of things on our hearts today and lots of people we care about, so let's open with a time of prayer. Father, we recognize that You are a good Father, that You care for us, that Your name is holy and great and worthy to be praised. Yet, Lord, as You know, there's a great many things that weigh on each of us as we come today in the middle of our weeks, as life rages on. Lord, there's people who are sick that we care about, and we pray that You would hold them in Your hands and care for them. There's those with burdens and cares weighing on them. I pray that You would give peace and comfort and direction from You. Lord, as we come as a church, we pray that You would guide and direct us with Your hand, that we would not have anything to fear as long as You are near. And Lord, we pray that you would draw near to us as we draw near to you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I believe I've mentioned before, I once upon a time used to work at Lowe's. If you've ever gone into a home improvement store, you probably have noticed those poor souls in the red vests or blue vests if you're a Home Depot kind of guy. Shame on you. But if you ever go into a home improvement store and see those poor, unfortunate souls with the vests who have been standing on the concrete for 7.5 hours, they only have a half hour more to go before their shift is over and you have a question and they don't want to talk to you. Right? It's unfortunate that customer service associates sometimes aren't very good at customer service, but that's the truth of life sometimes. It's unfortunate for multiple reasons. One, you're a customer and you have help. You have a need for help, and you see someone who could help you and they just want to run away. Secondly, it doesn't look good on the company when you wear the vest and you don't perform with the purpose and mission, the ideals of the company that you represent. A Lowe's employee, or any other employee for that matter, needs to have an identity, a purpose, and a mission that supports that of their company, the people that they represent. In this case, an employee at a home improvement store is all about customer service. Customer service, customer service. Do I see a customer? Can I help a customer? That's what makes a good customer employee. Their identity, as they zip up the vest, is to help people, to be there for their needs. Dirty people, stinky people, angry people, it doesn't matter. You're going to help them and then go to the washroom and take a breath and get ready for the next person after that. The way that you do that is by providing service. You have a purpose. Your purpose, Mr. Red Vest, is to go help people. So don't turn your tail and run away and go hide in the break room. Go help people. Answer their questions. Listen to them. There's a purpose that you fulfill, and there's a mission, a way that you fulfill it as you then are attentive, as you maybe have a piece of gum in your mouth so you have good breath, and as you're listening, as you're talking, as you study the layout of the store, and you know that the light bulbs are on aisle 12. Otherwise, you wouldn't be very good in your identity, mission, or purpose as a Lowe's employee. The same thing can go for any profession. A firefighter, if I can honor my friend Luke back there, puts on the iconic red hat or the firefighting uniform, and they have an identity. I am a firefighter. I am someone who helps. I seek the welfare of people. I teach people about safety. Identity blends into purpose. I put out fires. And the way that you do that is by training, by studying, and by doing all of the amazing things that Luke does back there. We're grateful for him. Name any profession, any role, police officer, a professor, a teacher, a doctor, a cook. You have an identity, you have a purpose, and you have a mission. Our text today, as we look to the book of Titus, is none different for us as Christians. Christians have an identity. That identity gives us a purpose, and how we live out that purpose forms our mission. As we look at Titus 1, verses 1 through 4 today, we're going to see Paul's identity, purpose, and mission, and we're going to see that we ought to emulate him by adopting his identity, purpose, and mission to be our own. The word of the Lord comes to us today from the book of Titus, chapter 1, verses 1 through 4. If you have your Bibles, you can open there with me if you haven't already, or we can follow along on the slides. If you're willing and able, please stand with me for the reading of God's word. This is the word of God. Paul, a servant of God and an apostle of Jesus Christ, for the sake of the faith of God's elect and their knowledge of the truth, which accords with godliness, in hope of eternal life, which God, who never lies, promised before the ages began, and at the proper time manifested in his word, through the preaching with which I have been entrusted by the command of God our Savior. To Titus, my true child in a common faith. Grace and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus, our Savior. Amen. You may be seated. I'm excited to dive into the book of Titus with all of us. And I feel like we ought to spend, at least today, spending time on just this introduction. Paul's epistles, his letters, always begin with a reference to the sender or the person writing. There's a reference to me. There's a reference to the recipient and a greeting. In this case, we have three parts to this text. Paul's reference to himself, Paul's reference to Titus, and a greeting, grace and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Savior. It's fairly straightforward. But before we get into the bulk of actually what he's writing to Titus about, there's something significant that I'd like to slow down and see about Paul and the way that he identifies himself in the first section of this introduction. Again, he refers to himself. He gives a reference to himself to give himself credibility, authority. This is the one that is writing to you, and it's why you should listen to him. As we've seen, we're looking at these three words, Paul's identity, purpose, and mission. And as we start, we're going to first look at what Paul considered his identity to be. Verse 1. Paul, a servant of God and an apostle of Jesus Christ. These terms are significant terms, and they're significant for us to know. The term servant is a word that we want to be referred to ourselves. Paul refers to himself as a servant. The term is a little complicated because it also means slave, and some of your translations might describe it as a slave of Christ or slaves of Christ Jesus. In this case, a slave or a servant of God. The term slave is difficult for us to wrap our minds around because the first thing that we think about is usually the Atlantic slave trade and the injustice committed by those, especially during that time period, as slavery was very harsh and not right. Back in the Greek-Roman world, slavery was a lot different than the Atlantic slave trade that we think of. Slavery was more common and a way for folks to get themselves out of debt. If you had a debt, if you needed to borrow money, you could sell yourself as an indentured servant or as a bond servant to pay for that debt, and you could work yourself out of it. It was a position that had a lot more respect at the time than what we think about when we think of the term slavery, but it is still a position that has some connotations to it. To be a slave was to be purchased or owned or under the work or responsibility to someone else who is in charge of your life. How many of us have credit cards? I think all of us have credit cards. How many of us take out loans and borrow money? I think a lot of us do. It's kind of hard not to buy a house without some sort of a loan, right? In that case, we are slaves, the Bible says, to the one that we are debtors to. And the concept is kind of similar. Paul views himself as a servant, as a slave, as someone who belongs to someone else. God has ownership of his life. He belongs to God. God has purchased him, bought him with a price. We'll see more of that in a second. But God, Paul's identity is completely under God in his service, ownership to the Lord. There's a second term that Paul uses to describe his identity, and that is the term apostle. The word apostle means sent one or messenger. It comes from the verb that means to send. So Paul, not only as someone who is a servant to the Lord, but as someone who is owned by God, purchased by God, belonging to God, he's also sent by God. Sent by God with a message to proclaim. And we have here Paul's authority in the office of apostle. This office is unique and was given to Paul and the other disciples as those who saw the risen Lord face to face and were given special authority at the beginning of the church to proclaim and to teach because they saw the risen Christ. They were called, equipped, and sent forth as God's authoritative messengers to start the church. In that sense of the term, apostle is not something that describes us. There were the 12 apostles, Paul included, and we are not in that office. However, there is a sense in which we are those who are sent by God. 2 Corinthians describes us as we are his ambassadors, sent to proclaim God's word and to call others to hear about who God is. We also, in a special sense, but not the same sense, are called by God to be his own, equipped by God to do what is good and right and to speak the truth, and sent forth as God's authoritative messengers to tell the world the good news that they need to hear about the gospel of Jesus Christ. Paul viewed himself as being completely owned, belonging to the Lord, and on a mission sent by him as his messenger. And that ought to be the identity of every Christian as well. You may not be the Apostle Paul, and you may not be in an apostolic office, but you are, as a Christian, redeemed by God, purchased, bought with a price, the blood of Christ, and equipped, made new, so that you can do God's work and speak the words that God has given to you to speak. Those words may not be the most eloquent words of high and lofty wisdom, right? But Paul argues in 1 Corinthians that it's not about lofty words of eloquence or wisdom. It's about the cross of Christ and proclaiming that Jesus died for me. Paul says, "For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain." That was not only his identity, it was his message. He says, you are not your own. You have been bought with a price. That was his identity and his message. He says in Galatians 2:20, I have been crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. That was his identity and his message. He says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, we have concluded this, that one has died, and he died for all, so that those who live may no longer live for themselves, but for him who for their sake died and was raised. That was his identity and message. Paul's identity, even though it is his, and we don't take his identity to ourselves as Paul, I'm Jacob, you're you. But Paul's identity should also be ours. It is the identity of a Christian to be a servant and a sent one, messenger of Jesus Christ. Secondly, we need to adopt Paul's purpose. As Paul writes to Titus, he writes describing who he is, that he has authority to be listened to, authority to direct and to order the church. He also has a purpose that validates and describes his authority as a worker of the Lord. Verse 1, the second half of verse 1. For, again, he is a servant of God and an apostle of Jesus Christ for a reason, for a purpose. For the sake of the faith of God's elect and their knowledge of the truth, which accords in godliness, in hope of eternal life, which God, who never lies, promised before the ages began and at the proper time manifested in his word. Paul recognizes that he's not simply a servant of God and an apostle of Christ Jesus so that he can go on a big, long vacation and travel the Roman world and see the sights, right? He's not on a tour of the world. He's on a purposeful mission, and his purpose is to see God's people come to faith and knowledge of the truth. In this first section here at the end of verse 1, we see that these two elements are the key components to what Paul's purpose was. I exist, my purpose is for the faith of God's chosen, of God's people. God's people need to believe. And my job is to help them believe and to help them come to a knowledge of the truth. Certainly, God works in each and every human heart to draw us to Him, to lead us to faith, and to give us the knowledge of the truth from His Word. In that sense, God is able to do that in our hearts without the help of any one human being. We don't need a priest. We don't need a prophet, per se, because we have the Spirit of God that moves in our hearts. However, I don't think there's any one of us that could say that we came to Christ without the help or communication with another human being, whether it was your parents that led you to the Lord, or a friend, or a coworker, or somebody else in your life that looked at you and saw someone that needed to believe and to know the truth. Paul exists to be that person, to see God's people, and again, those who may not yet be God's people. As God said to Paul, I have many people in this city who are yet to come into the fold. But to look at those who might be God's people and to work and to give yourself for their faith, for their knowledge of the truth. That's Paul's purpose. But not only that, he does this for the sake of their faith, for the sake of their knowledge, in a certain mindset, in hope of eternal life. We work and we labor as Christians, not thinking that the world is going to end and then there's nothing. We work and we labor as Christians, knowing that there is life beyond the grave, that Jesus promises us eternal life with Him, and that that is our hope that cannot be taken away from us, our inheritance, that we have this hope of being with God forever, of every tear being wiped away, of things being made right. And this promise that God gives of eternal life, of faith in that eternal life, and knowledge in that truth, that promise cannot be taken away. It is not a lie. Unlike perhaps some of those who live in Crete, as we'll see next week, the Cretans tend to be liars. They're always liars. In fact, God never lies. His truth is steadfast and sure. He is good to all generations. And He has promised this promise of hope, of eternal life, before the ages began, before time, before the creation of the world. God knew you, and God formed you so that you would be His own, that you would come to Him and find everything you need in His arms. This promise was hidden for a time. Even though God has established this promise of hope, of eternal life in Christ Jesus through faith and knowledge of the truth, before the ages began, it wasn't always revealed to God's people in this plain way until now. The beginning of verse 3, at the proper time, God has manifested His word and revealed the promise that He has established before the ages began. And that promise, that revealing, again, is so that God's people would respond to Him in faith, in knowledge of the truth, and in hope of eternal life. That's Paul's purpose, and it should be your purpose too. Hear me out. I know that not all of us are called to journey around as missionaries and plant churches. I know that all of us are not the Apostle Paul with the gifts and calling that Paul had specifically. We are not called to be apostles of Jesus Christ with authority to start and build the church. However, God does say to you, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. He does call you to be disciple makers, to go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. You are the exact person God wants to reach out to the people in your life. There's nobody who can better do it other than you. You have contacts, you have friends that God would reach if we would respond and be obedient. And as for Paul's sake, he says, this is my purpose. For, again, our companies, our programs, it's good for any company and program to have a purpose or a vision statement. What do you exist to do? What is your purpose? What are you trying to accomplish? If we don't have clarity in our businesses or in our programs, our ministries even, in what we're trying to do, what we're trying to accomplish, we're not going to be very effective in any labor that we set out to do. Having clarity in purpose and vision is not only something that's necessary for the world, it's something that's necessary for Christians. God has called you to be satisfied in his love, to find washing and renewal, regeneration in the blood of Christ, to be forgiven of your sins and to be made clean, to be adopted as a son and daughter of the King.
Amen.
That's amazing. But it's not all that God has called you to. He's also called you to be an ambassador, someone who represents him and heralds his message to everyone. There's a parable I was reading to my children this week of the master of the feast who sends out his servants into the streets. He calls to them, come, everyone, come to the feast. There are some people who hear the invitation and they say, I've got better things to do. I'm busy. I got to go do something. I should have done it like last week, but I still haven't done it yet, so I'm going to go do it. And the messengers come back and they tell the king they were invited and we told the message, but they did not come. And so the master sends them out into the streets and the alleys, into the farms, into the fields. And he says, come to the feast. It's not a complicated message. You don't need to go to Bible school or to seminary to be able to proclaim that message. Your identity in Christ, if you have come yourself, is your message. I was a sinner. I was lost in my sin, but I came to Jesus and I found forgiveness and I found life. He is my Father and he can be your Father too. As you go and call out to people, come to the King, come to the feast, your purpose is also Paul's purpose. If your life exists for God's glory, for the sake of the faith of God's people, for their knowledge of the truth, that they may have hope in eternal life. Is there any higher calling? Paul says in Colossians 1:28, him we proclaim, warning and teaching every man with all wisdom, that we might present every man mature in Christ. Sometimes we may not know exactly where we lie in the spectrum of presenting someone mature in Christ. Sometimes you're there planting a seed and God brings them to faith later. Sometimes you're there working through somebody through a time of crisis, giving them comfort and hope and the answers of truth that they need to hear. Sometimes you're there actually saying the gospel to someone and leading them to respond in faith and in repentance. Sometimes you're explaining the way of God more fully to someone. Either way, when you work, when you labor to love people and to bring them to a knowledge of the truth, you are laboring with a purpose statement, a vision statement that I cannot find better described other than in these succinct verses, that you exist for the sake of the faith of God's people, for the knowledge of their knowledge of the truth in hope of eternal life. The knowledge of the truth accords with godliness. God's people will grow in godliness as they grow in faith and in truth. But will you labor for their knowledge, for their faith? Paul's purpose should be the purpose of every Christian, even you. Thirdly, we should adopt Paul's mission. There's Paul's identity. Again, who he is determines his purpose, determines his message. His purpose is for the sake of the faith of God's people. But Paul also has a mission, something that he's immediately doing to accomplish his purpose, the second half of verse 3. God, at the proper time, manifested in his word through the preaching with which I have been entrusted by the command of God, our Savior. Again, Paul's mission, his method, the way that he's going to accomplish the sake of the faith of God's people, their knowledge of the truth, so that they may have godliness and hope of eternal life, is by preaching the word of God and fulfilling that commission that he's been entrusted with by the command of God himself. Before any of you start to get nervous, I'm not expecting all of you to come up here and preach, right? Paul is called to preach the word, and I am called to preach the word, and maybe you are not in the same sense of the word preach. But as I've shared with us before, there's another sense of the word preach that I can specifically apply to Paul and that I can generally apply to us. When you take God's word and explain it to those whom God would have hear it, God's people, so that they understand it and know how to apply it to their lives, you preach the word. It's different than teaching. To teach, you can have a big head. You know what it means. You know everything about it. You know the background. You know. But to preach is to explain for the sake of knowledge and practical living, immediate application. God is good. We are sinful. God has given a ransom price, a payment of atonement that covers our sin for us in the person of Jesus Christ. And you need to believe. God's word made known, understood, and given with a clear action for response. Preaching the gospel, preaching God's word, is something that every Christian has to do if they are to be making disciples of all nations. Paul's mission, again, is not just to preach the word by himself because he wanted to, because he chose to. You know, someday I think I'm going to just get up and preach God's word because I think that's what I want to do when I grow up. No, that's not how it works. The way it works is that God calls you and commissions you. If there's anybody who just decides, I'm going to preach God's word without the commissioning of God, that's what we call a false prophet, a false teacher, someone who speaks in the name of the Lord but is not sent by the Lord. Paul speaks and he preaches God's word as I have been entrusted by the command of God, our Savior. Paul was given a special office as apostle to preach in a special way, in a way that we are not. However, we as God's people are called, commissioned. Before you were in the womb, I knew you. God has formed you intricately, and he has called you to come and to be a child of the King. He's called you to lay aside your life, to lay down your life that you might find it in Christ. And finding your life in Christ, he commissions you to go and make disciples of all nations. Your identity, I am a child of the King, I am redeemed, I am washed by the blood of Christ, is your purpose. I work so that other people may be children of the King, may be redeemed, may be washed by the blood of Christ. And your mission, your message, come to the King, be washed by the blood of Christ, become a child of God. And that message starts because you were called, you were chosen, you were commissioned. Our mission starts with our commission. If you are sent by Lowe's, you zip up the red vest, you're all about customer service. You serve people. You deliver the goods. You represent the company. You represent the values of the company. If you are sent as a firefighter from a fire station, you exist to put out fires, to teach people about safety, to help the helpless. If you are sent by a bank, you exist to be a person above repute, to be good at math, to be trustworthy, and to take good care of money because you are sent by a bank. Do you see how identity forms purpose and mission, who you are, what you do? If you're sent by the king, you're an ambassador. You represent the king and his authority to his kingdom. You speak his words and nothing but what the king authorizes you to speak. If you are sent by God, you know him. You spend time at his feet. You represent him in the way that you live your life. You walk in a manner worthy of the calling of the gospel. And you herald that gospel with your life and with your words, because that is the message that God would have for us to share. Paul writes in this way to Titus because he has things that Titus needs to know, and he has things that the church in Crete needs to know, that Paul is an authoritative messenger of the king, that we should listen to him, that we should submit to what he has to say, and that we should order the church and follow him in these ways. I look forward to getting into the rest of Titus and seeing how we as a church can grow in a way that is healthy and fitting, that we as a people of God might be zealous for good works. But here, as Paul writes to Titus, we see his identity, his purpose, and his mission, and that should be our own. As we transition to a time of communion, and I welcome those who are going to serve communion to go ahead and come up, we recognize that communion represents who we are in Christ. Jesus told his followers, "Do this in remembrance of me, remember who you are in me, that you are purchased, that you are bought, that you are made new." As we take these elements, we're going to think about the body of Christ. We'll start with the bread. The body of Christ, which was given for you, that though you have no righteousness of your own, God has given you a righteousness through his Son and called you to be his child, a son or daughter of the king, because you are seen with the very white clothing of Jesus, the righteousness of Jesus. His body is given for you, and we see that here. Let me pray. Lord, as we come to this time of communion, we just pray that you would work, that you would help us to remember who we are. Our identity as Christians is nothing new, is nothing changed from Paul's own consideration, that we are servants. We are slaves of God, not in a negative sense, but in a sense that describes the way that you have bought us with a price, the way that you are our Father, the way that you own us, the way that we belong to you. We pray that as we consider these things, you would work in our hearts and give us a sense of joy. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. As the men pass out the bread, take one, pass the plate, and we'll take it together. As we consider the body of the Lord, we consider his sacrifice for us, that it was me that should have died on that cross for my sins that I deserved. But Jesus died there for me so that I could be forgiven, I could be a child of God. For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that on the night that the Lord Jesus was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had broke it, he gave thanks and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." As we look to the cup, not only do we often symbolize the cup as a picture of Jesus' blood that is spilled for us in sacrifice that covers our sin, but sometimes we forget about the fact that the cup symbolizes a cup of wine, a cup of celebration. Jesus says, "I tell you the truth, I will not drink of this cup again until I drink it anew in my Father's kingdom." We recognize that the blood of Jesus has been spilled for us, and we also recognize that we have a new covenant in his blood, that we are made new, that we have the ability to be washed as we come to Jesus in faith and repentance. As we take the cup, I encourage you to consider your place before the Lord, that you come to the Lord Jesus in faith and in repentance, because this is the new covenant that we have in Christ, and it is our eternal hope that we are in him, that we will rejoice with him again as we see him in heaven. Take the cup and we'll take it together.
Celebrate the cup, we look forward to our hope in Christ forever. Together, it's not an individual thing, we will be with him as his family. In the same way, also after supper, he took the cup, saying, This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me.
Praise the Lord.
Father, we praise you that you are good,
that you have given us everything we need for life, for faith, that you call us to come to you because of the sacrifice that is made ours in Christ Jesus. We pray that you would continue to grow us as a church, as your people, in our faith, that you would grow us in the knowledge of the truth, that you would grow us in measures of godliness and in hope of eternal life, that we would be called, equipped, and sent as your authoritative messengers to those who need to hear the words of life. We pray this in your name. Amen.
Is this on? Yeah, okay. Our last song for the day is There's Power in the Blood. So would you all please stand with us as we sing through this? It's a damn bongi.
Would you be free from your burden of sin? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you our evil a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be free from your passion and pride? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Come for a cleansing to Calvary's side. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be whiter, much whiter than snow? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Sin stains are lost in its life-giving flow. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you do service for Jesus your King? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you live daily his praises to sing? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb.
Amen. Well, I encourage you to hang out with each other after the service. There's some donuts out here that need to find a home. And Thomas, don't take them all home. Share some with them. No, just teasing, Thomas. I love you. As we go, we recognize that we are cleansed by the blood of Jesus and called to be priests, to lead other people to the Lord. So let's say this together. To him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood and made us a kingdom, priest to his God and Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. May the Lord bless you.